Melbourne Cup is about more than racing. It's about the stories behind the spectacle. And racing storyteller Neil Kearney joins us now to take us through some of his all-time memorable moments and characters. Neil, it's great to see you, mate.
It's great to see you. And I hope, Ange, you haven't gone the early crow on the bomb. Because the great thing about the Melbourne Cup is you've got to wait. It's about patience, as Bart Cummings would say. And when you get to the clock tower, count to 10. So if the rain comes at 12:30, you're going to have egg on your face.
But then, no, but my tip stockman will do well.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm on Grand Promenade. He is the rank outsider.
OK, Grand Promenade. Good to know. Now, I want to hear some of your amazing stories. We might start with this one, which stars yourself. Have a look.
You finished.
Who wants that?
Who wants
that?
I don't care. I don't care.
This is the Melbourne Cup.
I don't care. We came here. We finished second. We would have been happy with last.
Yeah, what a run it was by your horse, eh? Hey, that was a great run.
Oh, what a brilliant moment. What was going on there?
Well, it's going to take a while to explain, but those guys were a couple of nitwit Irishmen who just got off a plane. They did about 3 gallons of alcohol that morning. They were the owners of a horse called Heartbreak City. It was the 2016 Melbourne Cup, and Heartbreak City ran second. And they were ecstatic when the race finished. And I had to explain to them that actually the horse had finished second, not first. But the truth of the matter was that they had backed that horse for the place. And they had had money on it in Britain, and they had money on it in Australia. They won more than $1 million.
Wow!
That
in betting. So you can see why that guy there, he not only drank 3 gallons of beer that day, but I don't reckon he slept since, because they had such a fantastic time at the Melbourne Cup. And it's part of the whole fabric of the Melbourne Cup,
yeah,
is that people do outrageous, larger-than-life things.
That's true.
And Aiden that day, he did outrageous things.
Let's wind the clock back a bit to a great tale behind a horse called Nimblefoot. What's the story there?
Well, this is a bit of a Halloween-like story from last night, eh? It's a bittersweet. But Nimblefoot ran in the Melbourne Cup in 1870. Ooh. And his owner was a man named Walter Craig, who was the publican at Craig's Hotel in Ballarat. Still a very fine hotel. Anyway, about 3 weeks before the Melbourne Cup, Walter Craig had a very unusual dream. And he dreamt that a horse carrying his colours would win the Melbourne Cup, but that the jockey would be wearing a black armband.
Oh.
So he came down to breakfast next morning, told everyone in the pub about his bizarre dream, and that dream was published in the Ballarat Courier newspaper 3 weeks before the Melbourne Cup.
Right.
Sure enough, Nimblefoot won the 1870 Melbourne Cup. But sadly, the jockey was wearing a black armband, because 3 nights before the Melbourne Cup was run, Walter Craig died in his sleep.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my goodness. I've got goosebumps then.
Yeah.
Now, one of the all-time greatest Melbourne Cup tales was, of course, Farlab and his strapper, Tommy Woodcock.
Yeah.
Why have they kept up such a special place in history, do you think?
Oh, I think Farlap will always have a place. Tommy Woodcock, because he was a strapper, and strappers are the people that love horses. They are probably the least celebrated people on a racetrack, probably the least financially rewarded. But it's wonderful that the Victoria Racing Club has a prize for the strapper of the Melbourne Cup winner today, and that is the Tommy Woodcock trophy.
Yeah.
And you only got to look at Tommy Woodcock. And that's not Tommy there, but he was the little strapper leading the horse around. He loved him. He loved horses, and he was the epitome of how people should feel about horse racing.
Another famous character would have to be Bart Cummings, his Cup King with 12 wins under his belt. Tell us about his legacy.
Well, I guess his legacy now is his two grandsons, Edward and James, who are both outstanding ambassadors, terrific raconteurs, very funny and very down-to-earth young men for people who've been brought up in a fairly lush position.
Yeah.
But they are the legacy. But as for Bart, we'll always cling to the great moments of Bart. So many thousands of people go up to Bart's statue and give him a bit of a pat on the head, which I'm sure he would love.
Yeah.
But there'll never be another Bart. He was just such a witty, dry, calm character. Yeah. He got better with age and he was a fantastic old guy.
So true.
Mm. I can't wait to see what kind of history will be written here at the track today.
Oh, yes.
It'll be a doozy. Thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate your time. Who's your tip again?
Oh, my tip will be the Craig Williams-ridden Who Your Ma, because I hear...
Who Your Ma?
Yes, because yesterday my daughter was talking to Craig. Craig said if his daughter wants a dog, a spaniel, mm-hmm. and if Craig rides the Melbourne Cup winner today, he'll buy the spaniel for his daughter. Right. So you couldn't have a greater incentive than that. So Craig Williams, number 12 in the Melbourne Cup.
And Gay Waterhouse trained, yeah?
Yep.
Yeah, that's also quite
good. Get on.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Neil.